Welcome back, students. Next in line for us to study is the more complicated study design known as a cohort study. A cohort is a group of people who share common characteristic or experience in a given period of time. So that is basically the definition of cohort. In layman's term, again, cohort is a group of people who have some exposure in common or some event in common. To give you some examples, somebody who is working in the radiology department, this would consist of a radiological cohort. Somebody who was born in the year 2000. So all the people who are born in the year 2000 would form a birth cohort. Somebody who is working in a dye industry. So all the people working in a dye industry can make a occupational cohort. These are some of the common examples of cohorts that we use in epidemiology. Obviously, you can see that cohorts can be defined in a number of ways. What are the features of cohort study? The cohort are identified prior to the appearance of the disease under investigation. So this is one of the chief differences between a case control and a cohort study. Remember, we are talking about analytical studies. The first analytical study that we saw was case control study. The second analytical study that we are seeing is the cohort study. Okay, if you can remember, the first diagram that we had started the lecture with was the time thing. We went back in time for case control studies and we will be going forward in time with the cohort studies. The study groups were defined or observed over a period of time to determine the frequency of disease amongst them. So now what is going to happen in the cohort study? Only exposure is there. Disease is not there. As you can see, this is a very challenging study. We are having two groups. These now are not cases and controls. In a cohort study, there would be people exposed and people who are not exposed. We will be following these two groups called as cohorts for a cohort study. And we will go further and we will see if the disease develops. If the disease is developing more in the people who show exposure, then we say that the exposure causes the disease. If such a relation is not found, we cannot conclude. The study proceeds from cause to effect. So this is what basically a cohort is. Feature of cohort study: it is an observational design comparing individuals with known risk factors or exposures with others without the risk factor or exposure. We look for differences in the risk of a disease over time. It is the best observational design. It is very complicated, very time consuming and very long. Most of the cohorts would at least go on for a few years. So cohort studies take a very long time. Many a times by the time a cohort study is finished, the investigator himself is not there. So the investigator himself dies. Cohort studies are very long. Usually data is collected prospectively. That is forward looking. We saw what prospective and retrospective means. So the same meaning, okay? Prospective, that is used here. We look forward. It is a forward looking study. When do you do a cohort study? What are the indications of a cohort study? A cohort study is done when there is actually available a very good quality of evidence regarding the association between the cause and the effect. I would not at all be interested in doing a cohort study wherein the hypothesis is not well formed. Okay, because I do not want to waste my time and money, years together and millions of dollars probably, on trying to prove a hypothesis that had no basis. Okay, that was bound to fail. That was very ill informed. So cohort studies are only done on hypothesis which you are fairly certain about. You are almost certain that this is true, but you need a study to put it in black and white. Use a cohort study. If you have an ill-defined hypothesis, it is just your gut feeling, cohort study is a very bad design. When exposure is rare, but the incidence of disease among exposed is high. Again, the same thing. Exposure is rare, but the disease among exposed is high. What happens if the exposure is rare and the disease among exposed is also rare? So I'm talking about two rares here. Exposure is rare and the disease is also rare. Run away from a cohort study. Never ever do it. Okay? It is bound to again fail miserably. You will never get the sample size and the whole study will be a big mistake. So I can do a cohort study where the exposure is rare, but the disease in this exposed population is very high. To give you a classical example to make you understand is the prevalence of leukemia in patients who have exposed to repeated radiation. So you see, not many people get extended periods of radiation. There are very few people who get radiation. But if you see the disease, leukemia or any other cancer for these people who have been radiated, that is very, very high. So you can do a cohort there. That would be justified. Although the exposure is rare, the disease is fairly common. So a cohort can be done in this case. If the disease was rare, please do not attempt a cohort study. Okay, you will get nothing. Nobody will develop cancer because the sample size would be very small and the study would fail because you will get nobody with the disease. Okay, you can do a cohort study when attrition of the study population can be minimized. Now we will start talking about attrition. Attrition is what? You talk of attrition for a software industry, you talk of attrition for a medical school. Attrition means lost to follow, went away, resigned. Okay, I don't have him anymore. That is attrition. You had somebody, now he is not at your disposal. That is attrition. For us, he was a study subject, lost to follow. I do not know what, something happened. Either he died, that is an outcome. Either he migrated, he is not cooperating anymore. He is not answering my phone calls. He is not filling up the questionnaires. He is not giving his blood or urine sample for test. These are all examples of attrition. So the data that I need from the person is no more available with me. That is attrition. So when attrition of the study population can be minimized, compare this to the case control study. Just to make it more clear, there was no problem of attrition as the disease was already there. So I do not have to follow the patients in time and therefore there is no problem of attrition. In cohort study, I have a big problem of attrition. And last but not the least, maybe the most important factor, when you have ample funds at your disposal, at that point only you can attempt a cohort study because this is a very expensive study design. Right now on your screens, you have a framework of cohort study. If you compare this again with the case control framework, we were worried about cases and controls. Here, we are not worried about cases and controls. What we have at hand is persons who are exposed and persons who are not exposed. On the left hand side here, you have this exposure to putative etiological agent. So the group of interest is this: persons who are exposed, represented as A plus B. The cursor is there right now. This is what we are interested in. This is what we have in a cohort study. A plus B. Again, reminding you again, A, B, C, D. This is the sequence we write, A, B, C, D. In case you have learned the formulas this way, please remember A, B, C, D. If you jumble up A, B, C, D, all the formulas go wrong. And this is not exposed. Not exposed group consists of C plus D. So these are the two groups, or these are the two cohorts which we are interested in. Precautions while assembling the cohorts. The first precaution is that the cohorts must be free from the disease understudy. Obviously, common sense tells me if he has disease, what do I determine? He already has the disease. Okay, so the person should be free from the disease because I want to determine the disease in future. He should right now just have the exposure. I am going to detect the disease in him in the future. If he has disease now, he is of no use to me. Both the groups should be equally susceptible to the disease under study. Obvious reasons, both the groups should be able to develop the disease. Okay, here again you can introduce a very important bias. If the control group is not susceptible to the disease, your hypothesis will automatically be proved. So therefore, to avoid that kind of bias, I need both the groups to be susceptible to the disease. The only differentiating factor should be the etiological agent which is present in your cohort. Both the groups should be comparable in respect to all the possible variables which may influence the frequency of the disease. This is true for any research design. If you have two groups, all the demographic or other variables should be equally distributed so that they are comparable to each other. The diagnostic and eligibility criteria for the disease must be defined beforehand. Again, why is it specially mentioned? Isn't this understood? Isn't this common sense? It is common sense. It is specially mentioned because, as I said, cohorts are very long studies. More often than not, you see that these definitions of diseases get revised. Okay, every now and then your medicine professor would be asking you, go and look at the recent definitions of hypertension. Go and look at the recent values of diabetes mellitus. So you know that these definitions get revised. Okay, and this can pose a big problem to you. If you undertake a cohort study and the definition of the disease changes midway, then the whole effort can go in vain. So therefore, this is very important to ascertain that the definitions would not change in between. Okay, coming to the steps in cohort study. How actually we do a cohort study? The first step is selection of study subjects. Second one is obtaining data on exposure. Third is selection of a comparison group. Fourth is follow-up, and the last one is analysis. Again, you are fortunate, you do not have to write a theory at least now on this, so therefore you need not require to have the sequence or completely mucked up, but you need to know what comes after what. The first step of a cohort, selection of study subjects. You can select the study subjects from the general population. This usually in cohort studies is not very common and it is not very easy. Assembling a cohort from a general population requires you to exactly know who is exposed and who is not exposed. Usually for environmental contaminants, this demarcation is not clear. So there is a lot of overlap, and therefore this is difficult to, the sample is difficult to get from the general population. Usually cohorts are done on selected groups of population, which can be exposed group. The examples I gave you, group of radiologists, group of dentists. Say you have a hypothesis that infertility is very common in dentists. So you compare dentists with some other professional doctors, okay, pediatricians, orthopedicians, gynecologists. Okay, why am I doing this? I am doing this so that I should compare apples with apples. If I compare dentists with laborers, I have too many differences, okay, socioeconomic, educational, background, cultural, habits, everything is different. So I am not comparing like to like. For comparison of like to like, I'll take dentists with some other medical professional, so that many of these factors are common. And now I have my cohort. The cohort would consist of all the dentists, and the comparison group would be some other doctor. Okay, and my hypothesis was that dentists have a higher prevalence of infertility. So this was a very small example giving you importance on multiple things that you have to take care while doing a cohort study. Next step was obtaining data on exposure. In a cohort study, since it is a forward-looking study, it is an ongoing study, the patients are at your disposal, you have much of liberty for obtaining data on exposure. The second benefit here is whatever data you collect is likely to be more authentic since this is done in real time. The patient comes to me today and I take his blood sugar value. I myself record the blood sugar value. He'll come to me the next month and such. So whatever data I have is more authentic. It is more real time. So I have good, the quality of the data that is collected in a cohort is very good. So you can do this data collection by either simple interviews or questionnaires. Now the method depends upon what your study is. Okay, so there is no gold standard that this is used or that is used. It depends upon what your study is based upon. Interviews or questionnaires, basically, you know, it is the easiest to do. You can have review of records. Say for example, you are working at a hospital which is affiliated to a insurance company. People come there to get their reports done and you just record their reports. So that would be an example of review of records. Medical examination or special tests. You yourself do a clinical examination. You yourself do some medical tests. For example, taking blood pressure, taking blood sugar, common examples. Or you can do a environmental survey. The benefit of doing an environmental survey is this is a good method of measuring environmental contaminants as far as the exposure is concerned. The second advantage is you can classify them. You can classify the environmental exposure as high, medium, low, or whatever classification you decide to have. Okay, so first of all, determination of exposure is possible. Second, categorization of the exposure is also possible as high, middle, or low. So that is done by environmental surveys. Coming to the next step, that is selection of comparison group. Now you need other group also to compare with the cohort. That is this comparison group. Three methods. You can have internal comparisons, you can have external comparisons, or you can have comparisons with the general population. First one is a funny sounding method. Internal comparison. I have a cohort. I'm going to study that cohort. How do I internally compare that cohort? A classical example would be when you have, like I said, in environmental surveys, gradations of exposure. If in a cohort you have gradations of exposure, you automatically can do internal comparisons. I know this is not very easy while I explain, so I'll again make it very easy. I will give you an example. I'll write something on the board so that you get this concept. Say for example, I have a pool of workers and they are uranium mine workers. Okay, so I have people who are working in offices, I have people who are working near the mines, I have people who are working inside the mines. Okay, so this is my cohort. This is my cohort. I'll be following this cohort forwards to determine if they develop lung cancer more frequently because of exposure to uranium. Okay, so this is all that I have. I just have one cohort. My comparison group is not ready yet. I have started the study. Now I am going to tell you, if I just have a cohort and if gradation is possible, how can I have a internal comparison? That means my comparison group will be automatically generated in my cohort. So this was my cohort. Let's divide this cohort into three parts. These guys are people who work in the office. Okay, the second group of people are people who work near the mine, and the third group of people are people working in the mine. Common sense tells me radiation exposure to people working in office would be minimal. Next exposed would be people working near the mines, and the maximum exposure would be found in people working inside the mines. So to begin with, I just had one cohort, but now I can see that I can distribute them into various groups and I have a comparison group. So I can compare this group with the rest, or you can have a different permutation also. You can make this group and compare it with this. So automatically there is an inherent method of generating a comparison group. This is called as internal comparison. External comparison. External comparison needs no explanation. What you understand, okay? You have a cohort, you have a comparison group, that is external comparison, wherein the comparison group could not be taken out from inside the cohort. I had these two groups with me beforehand. Third is comparison with general population. Not a very brilliant idea. Unfortunately, if you have a situation wherein a comparison group cannot be made available, okay, so you can use a comparison with the mortality rates of general population. So that is comparing with the general population. Here also a very big limitation is sometimes the data that you want from the general population is also not available. As I told you, crude death rate or such basic data would be available, but if you want some detailed data on a particular exposure, those kinds of data are not available with the general population. Follow-up, the next step in cohort study, follow-up. The essence of cohort study, okay, this is why cohort study is good. This is why we say that cohort study is a brilliant epidemiological design. Follow-up. Follow-up means taking regular measurements of the factors of your concern at intervals so that you have authentic good quality data. Follow-up can be done again by periodic medical examinations. As I told you, every month the patient comes to you, you take his blood sample for whatever tests you require to do for the study. Reviewing physical and hospital records, that all can also be done. Routine surveillance of death records. This is so important that this is put into the slides because the classical example of smoking and lung cancer, this was one of the method of data collection in that study, which was done by Dahl and Hill. The last method is mailed questionnaires, telephone calls, and periodic home visits. Mailed questionnaires is also a very good method of data collection. The problem is, again, not many people will reply you back with the questionnaire.